Okay, I think this is going to be slightly less exciting than the previous speaker. But I have a video too, but I think, again, probably one that won't engage you quite in quite the same way. So thanks to my co-authors, Dr. Ivan Reed and Dr. Henry Nabrensky. I've worked in holography. I started off working in holography 31 years ago. I haven't done very much recently. I'm actually a particle physicist. I'm going to talk about a form of holography which, for many of you, I guess, as holographers, you will have come across and never used, or if you've used it, it's been by accident. We had an interesting, I think, illustration of that in one of the talks yesterday, and that's inline holography. And I'll say a little bit about why I'm working in it and actually point you to the possible application in art. So because inline holography, it's kind of weird to stand in front of an audience like this and say, let me talk to you about a fundamental process in holography, but because most of you who are holographers are working in full color, off-axis techniques, I thought it was worth doing it. And again, the word digital hologram means at least three, if not four, completely different things in this audience I've discovered. So I actually want to say a little bit about what it means in this talk. And then the thrust really is to say a little bit about using GPUs, and I'll show you an example video. Well, inline holography is the original holographic technique invented by Gabor. It gives you It's a fantastically good technique for high-resolution imaging of very small particulates over fairly large depths. It's a higher far-field diffraction pattern that you record on some medium. Until fairly recently, that medium would, of course, have been holographic film, holographic plates. Nowadays, we use CCD or CMOS cameras. It gives you absolutely true three-dimensional information, but it has no parallax. So it's a kind of slightly weird hologram, and although you can obviously laser replay the ones on film and plates, there's not a lot of point looking at it because you're just staring straight down the laser beam. My application, or my most recent application of this, from which, as it were, this work on GPUs sprung, was working on underwater holography of plankton. So I've just used that as an illustration. So you take a beam of light. Typically, but not essentially, you work with collimated beams. You can certainly work with divergent beams, and there are some advantages and disadvantages, but working with a collimated beam preserves in a fairly nice way the geometric information. You transilluminate a collection of objects, either in a water tank or in air, and historically, you would have recorded it on Agfa-Gevaert film or something like that. If you've got moving objects, obviously, you're doing it with a pulsed laser. And then for replay, well, that's pretty straightforward. Just as in off-axis holography, you take your plate, you sprinkle magic chemicals over it, and you come back a few hours later, and you stick it back in the laser beam, and you get simultaneously replayed a real and a virtual image. And this, of course, is one of the big disadvantages of this type of holography and why people move very rapidly, at least in the Patniak sort of invented sideband holography, is that these are replayed simultaneously, and they co-interfere with each other. So the only real application for this inline is where you're working in the far field of the objects, the far field diffraction of the objects, where that mutual interference essentially becomes negligible. It's not that you can't make an inline hologram of slightly more macroscopic objects, but then you get a horrible interference between the simultaneously replayed and viewed real and virtual images. And of course, they have pseudoscopic and orthoscopic geometry. Well, in my world, digital inline holography is where you record on a digital pixel sensor, mostly, in fact, if possibly always so far, that's been a CCD or CMOS device. It doesn't have to be. But in terms of recording, all you're doing is replacing that holographic film or plate with a semiconductor pixel sensor. And replay is then by essentially computer-based algorithms. And the replay of each depth slice is highly computationally intensive. And my thanks to the speaker ended the session before the break for going in great detail through all the mathematical formulations, so I don't have to. Not quite, anyway. But so the theory says correctly, and Tyler and Thompson, and their names were mentioned again yesterday, is that what you're recording in an inline hologram is essentially something which is a fringe-encoded version of the Fourier transform of the object. Now, this is actually already kind of quite nice because you can see fairly quickly that if we're going to replay this at different depth slices without using a laser, then what you're going to be end up doing is taking fast Fourier transforms and then using phase functions. And that's exactly what we do. The technique of digital holography in this context in which I'm presenting it is certainly in no way limited to inline. It's just that, unfortunately for off-axis holography, the great strength is you've got essentially a frequency modulated encoding, so you have a carrier wave, which is related to your off-axis angle. And if you want a reasonable carrier wave, if you want a reasonable off-axis angle, which of course gives you that separation of the real and virtual images, and you want high resolution, as you well know, you want very, very fine-grained emulsions. Well, that's great, but we don't have very, very fine-grained pixel sensors. The smallest commercial one I know has got pixel spacing of just under 2 microns, and that would give you a kind of useful hologram with an off-axis, digital hologram with an off-axis angle of only about 10 degrees or so. But the principle is the same. So we're doing it, so the reason I make the point is that point one here, we multiply the hologram by a reference wave, which in our case is 1 plus a 0 complex part. If, however, you're using non-collimated beams, and rather more particularly, if you are actually recording an off-axis digital hologram, you've got to multiply it by a complex phase factor. You take a 2D Fourier transform, you multiply it by a transfer function, and here we have the Rayleigh-Sommerfeld coming back in again. Other techniques are applicable. And then you do an inverse 2D transform to get back to an image at a single depth slice. So if you want to replay a whole volume, you just loop around that process 3 and 4, 1,000 or 10,000 times, however you want to do it, and that's where the computational complexity comes in. So here's a simple example. The other point about inline holography, if you've either never used it or used it when you were 20 or 30 years younger, is that the information is fairly localized in its encoding. So an inline hologram of an object looks a little bit like a rather blurry, diffractive version of the object, which of course is exactly what it is. So the processing sequence is you record a digital hologram, you read it from the file, unless you've already got a magic camera which happens to have a power of 2 size of pixels, you then have to pad it out to a power of 2 because that's the way fast Fourier transform works. You do a forward 2D transform, you then apply something like the Rayleigh-Sommerfeld mathematics, which is dependent on the Z distance you want to record, and of course something like the wavelength. You can change the wavelength of replay as well, which might be relevant if you're recording in water and wanting to, as it were, visualize in air. And then you do a reverse 2D Fourier transform, and again, we want generally to look at information in intensity, so you have to take the power spectrum. So a GPU has come on the scene through primarily the gaming industry has been the driver for it. And replaying holograms is essentially a trivially parallel process. Every depth slice is completely independent from every other depth slice. So you can just throw out this hologram to a million processors and get them all to work with a different Z, different depth value, and then bring all the images back together. And a few years ago, that's exactly what we were looking at things like grid and cloud computing to do that. But nowadays, GPUs with their large numbers of cores are, for this application, much more suitable. So we have a host computer, standard PC, multi-core, but maybe only 4 or 5 cores, and then a GPU with its set of memory, typically several hundred cores. So you read the file, which you've recorded on a digital camera, into the host memory. The data is then transferred into GPU memory, and that's actually a rather critical and time-challenging step. You then do a fast-forward transform. This is highly optimized. The libraries exist using the FFTW code. You unpack it, because we've got complex code in place. You then use fast Fourier transform to transform it into another bit of memory, because you want to keep that original fast Fourier transform there. You then do a reverse fast Fourier transform in place, and that's one of the highly time-consuming steps. Then you want to actually look at this, so you need to get the magnitude of the data, so you go back to where you first went to in float. So you go from complex to floating. And then probably you want to remove the zero padding. I mean, that's not essential, but you might well want to do that. And then you need to normalize it. Well, again, you don't have to do that, but in terms of real-time display, you tend to want to keep the gray levels more or less the same. And then you transfer it all the way back to the host. And then you write it out. Now, the challenge is, it turns out, are such that the naive thing, and I only make this point because perhaps we hoped as well, but and you even see GPUs kind of marketed in certain areas as sort of, spend a few hundred pounds, plug it into the backplane of your PC, and all your calculations will go faster by some amazing fraction. Well, they will. I'll come to that in a second. But the other thing you can do, of course, with most GPUs these days is they also have video output, because then you can just go and, instead of writing it to disk, which would give you permanent storage, you can just write it out to a video screen. And that's one of the applications that we're certainly interested in, which is real-time exploration of a replayed digital hologram volume. So essentially this is a classic inline digital hologram of something. In fact, it's a power station ash, which is a nice simulacrum of plankton in water. There's a replayed hologram. There's a replayed part of it. The thing inline holography certainly does get you is high resolution. The smallest particles there are about 30 microns, and the resolution is about 5 or 6. So is it a plug-and-play solution? Absolutely not. What it's extremely good at is things like fast Fourier transforms, because there are sets of highly optimized libraries. And again, that multi-core process is one for which the fast Fourier transform algorithm decomposes very nicely. But you can see them. This is from about a couple of years ago. If you buy 3 Tesla S1070s, and that was something like $6,000, you get a speed up of about a factor of 3. That's not actually a very cost-effective solution. So simple-minded use isn't work. And the key challenge is actually taking that internal transformation, either the Rayleigh-Sommerfeld approach or the angular decomposition approach, and working out how to parallelize that onto a large number of cores. The fast Fourier transform, it's easy, and not surprisingly, the FFTW code is available from, you know, in the CUDA library. It's all the other bits of your code, and this is about as simple of application of GPUs as I can think of, which turn out to be the real stumbling block. So essentially, what might you want to do with real-world digital holography as opposed to using it as a demonstrator of GPUs? Well, essentially, there are, I think, 2 different user cases outside possibly the field of art. And one is that you get an expert user, human, and we're the best image processors, but we get bored, to look through a set of pre-recorded holograms and say, this hologram's got something interesting in it, do something with that. Or you might want a complete system which says, let's just run through with some sort of object extractor image classifier, and at the end of the day, somebody comes back after they've been out partying all night or something and says, what's my data set look like? And the reason I'm going to kind of look at those two is that the GPU is almost certainly not the only solution you're going to need if you want to do number 2. But where are we in terms of performance? Well, actually, once you refactor the code, which is the challenge, then you can actually get a vastly more useful set of results. Because the idea, for our point of view, was that somebody would just be able to drive their way through this reconstructive volume such that it would be a bit like replaying the whole volume at once and just choosing where to look. So we didn't feel there was any particular mileage in just producing a whole stack of 2D images and somebody just kind of looking through them like on a sort of slideshow sorter. You want people to be able to move through the image space. So anyway, if you do it more sensibly in terms of the code and use things like the 2070 or much more recently and much cheaper things like the 460 or 560 devices, you can replay 2x2 k-pixel holograms at pretty decent frame rates, and working at sort of 15, 16 frames a second is perfectly acceptable as a user interface, and we can do 4x4K holograms. So I'll show you a video briefly, but let me just come to conclusions 1, show you the video, and then conclusions 2. GPU are, I think, without any question, the hardware choice that you would make now, today. We achieved, roughly speaking, a factor of 200 speed up of the same underlying code and mathematical process from running on a standard, say, Xeon to running on a GPU. But that came at the price of a lot of work from some talented people and a lot of highly detailed optimization and a lot of actually highly detailed code profiling while running that code on the GPU as well. Powerful GPU are now available in laptops. For example, the Dell XPS 17 has got a GTX 555, which will replay these holograms at 4 or 5 frames a second, which is pretty good for a 4,096 hologram, I think. Shortly, they'll have the new Kepler GTX 480s coming out. And providing you're strong and you're happy to carry a kind of 5 kilo laptop and not put it anywhere near your legs or any other bit of you that might burn, because these things are pumping out staggering quantities of heat. So laptop is, it's more portable than a desktop, but not something to put on your lap. We tried that and gave up that very quickly. Anyway, let me just, I hope, show you. Now we'll come back. That one. Right, this is always the fatal point. Right, so this is a 4,096 hologram in terms of the process. This is a cloud of seeds. Now, if you saw our post that we had up, and you're going in depth, so you'll see them coming in and out of focus. So hopefully you saw our poster on this where I've been working with the talented artist Jane Wilton, who's interested in the visualization of breath. So this, in fact, the underlying hologram here that's being replayed is her blowing some small seeds. These seeds are about 1 millimeter in size, and it's being recorded with a 2 nanosecond doubled YAG laser. And this is just the same piece of software we have, and one of my colleagues is actually exploring this, and we're zooming in. This is not a pixel zoom, this is a real zoom. We're just mapping it higher resolution, and the edge resolution when the objects are in focus is on the scale of 3 or 4 micrometers. So it's just playing, and you can see them going in and out of focus. So you'll have to ask her how she might plan to use this in art. I mean, one thing is to allow people to explore the encapsulation of a breath as seen by sort of a little bit like particle imaging velocimetry with tracer particles. But I think there are other interesting ideas that she has about possibly using the data on the way to another artifact, so possibly some sort of sculptural artifact, but using the 3D data collected. And this is definitely the audience to ask. I wouldn't for a second claim that nobody has ever used inline holography in an artistic context, but if anybody knows that anyone has, I'd be very pleased to hear from them, because I haven't. I think it's unlikely, I guess, for obvious reasons. You can't generally see the results. Conclusions two. Well, if you want to actually extract objects, you've got to do some image processing. Now, you have to then know at which depth plane the object is in focus. In order to find the depth plane, it's a 3D image processing challenge, and you need to have a set of sequential depth planes all reconstructed for a 3D object class, three-dimensional object classifier or focusing algorithm to actually find the plane in which the object is truly in focus. Now, the challenge there is that image processing libraries are not trivially portable to GPUs. So I don't mean that there's any fundamental reason that they can't be, but if even doing something which is 100 lines of C took us several weeks and a lot of expert time to get it to run sensibly, large-scale imaging processing libraries are going to be more challenging. And you have that kind of legacy code issue. And the last point I'd like to make is that almost certainly, I think, the hybrid GPU grid cloud approach, if you want to do the whole thing of object reconstruction in 3D and classification, is going to be the solution. Thank you very much.